Good morning, everyone. I love this weather, the rain, the clouds, the wind. In fact, if you see anybody else here from Southern California, they're probably smiling on the rainiest days because we're not used to having this kind of weather right now. We've had 6 months of sun, 3 months of intense heat with, you know, brush fires in the mountains. So the idea of having rain is wonderful. In fact, if you see us dancing and singing in the rain like Gene Kelly sometime during the feast, you'll know it's the Southern California people who are here. Not too long ago, my wife and I had the privilege to attend an event sponsored by the Shoa Foundation at the University of Southern California. And at the time, I was a senior associate dean and chief financial officer at the college of the Letters of Arts and Sciences. And the Shoa Foundation was a unit within the college. And the USC Shoa Foundation was started by Steven Spielberg, who was inspired it by the making of the movie Schindler's List. Indeed, one of the speakers at the event that evening was an actual survivor, an actual Schindler's survivor. She was a young child at the time, was a worker in the factory. And it was an incredibly powerful evening. The event celebrated 20 years of the foundation, and at the core of the foundation's mission is to make audiovisual testimonies with survivors of the Holocaust and other genocides. And then it makes it available for education and social action. Right now, there are over 50,000 recorded eyewitness testimonies, not only of the Holocaust, but of Cambodia and Rwanda. The event my wife and I attended was entitled Ambassadors for Humanity, which highlighted the work of the foundation. And that evening also honored President Barack Obama for his efforts to protect human rights and his commitment to education and work advancing opportunities for all people. And the president, in accepting his award that evening, stated the following: "To you, to everyone at the Shoa Foundation, and for all that you've done for setting alight an eternal flame of testimony that can't be extinguished and cannot be denied, we express our deepest gratitude." Needless to say, that evening made a significant impact upon my wife, Kim, and I. And we could not help, as we left that evening, to reflect upon our calling. Please turn to 2 Corinthians 5, verse 20. And we thought of this scripture as we left that evening. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 20. It states in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 20, "Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." In other words, we are Christ's ambassadors to the world. Mr. Herbert Armstrong thought the concept was so important that he named a college after that. And the Ambassador Bible College carries on that legacy. Merriam-Webster's dictionary defines an ambassador as an official envoy, especially a diplomatic agent of the highest rank accredited to a foreign government or sovereign as a resident representative of his or her own government or sovereign or appointed or special, but often for a temporary assignment. In our walk in life, we represent another kingdom. Please turn to John 18, verse 36. John 18, verse 36. We too represent a foreign government on a temporary basis. We're appointed for a special but temporary assignment at this time. John 18, verse 36. John 18, verse 36, it states the following: "Jesus answered, 'My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight, so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here.' We are, all of us, ambassadors of another kingdom. We represent another kingdom, the kingdom of God. As noted in the definition of ambassador, the individual is appointed for a special and temporary assignment. We too are temporary on this earth. Mr. Cordyce talked about us being pilgrims on this earth yesterday. Our calling is special. It's an invitation from God, but it is temporary. We are not of the world, but we do live in it. It's not our responsibility to separate ourselves from the world as a hermit, but we are to live in it, to be an ambassador of Christ, to be an ambassador of the kingdom of God. We know this from Christ's prayer before he died. Turn to John 17, verse 15. John 17, verse 15. John 17, verse 15. It states in John 17, verse 15, I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. We are to be in the world. We are to function in the world, but yet we are to be an ambassador. So what does it mean to be an ambassador? For that answer, I would like to quote from the website of the Embassy of the United States in Ottawa, Canada. Seems a relevant website since my wife is Canadian, and for those in the Vancouver area, you might remember her as her maiden name, Popham, Kim Popham. And she grew up there. And so since we're in Canada, I thought it would be appropriate to point out to a site as this in Ottawa, Canada. It's a U.S. site. Within the website, there's a discussion of the role of a U.S. ambassador to Canada, and there are eight responsibilities therein. For the first five, I'm going to summarize them briefly. First, direct and coordinate all executive branch offices and personnel. The second is cooperate with the U.S. legislature and judicial branches so that U.S. foreign policy goals are advanced. A third one is reviewing communications to or from mission elements. A fourth is taking direct responsibility for the security of the mission. And the fifth, reshaping the mission to serve American interests and values. However, for the remainder of this message, I'd like to focus on the three remaining responsibilities of an ambassador that are mentioned within the website and how they apply to us, whether young or old, as ambassadors for Christ. The first of the three remaining responsibilities of a U.S. ambassador is that he or she speaks with one voice on U.S. policy, speaks with one voice to others on U.S. policy. A U.S. ambassador is to speak in one voice about policy. He is not to deviate from what the government has established. In our Christian lives, are we consistent? Are we consistent with our actions? Are we consistent with our speech? Is our voice, what we say and what we do, reflective of God working with us and through us? Is what we say consistent with our instruction manual? Or do we deviate from it? Turn to Romans 15, verse 5. And I'd like to read from the New International Version on this particular scripture. Romans 15, verse 5. It states in Romans 15, verse 5, may the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind towards each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with one mind and with one voice you may glorify the God of our Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is interesting that in this scripture we have the admonition that we are to be of one mind in one voice, but yet Paul also refers as to God as the one who gives endurance and encouragement. Why is that? It could be that in order to be one voice, in order to have the same spirit with one another, we need to be patient with one another. We need to endure together the trials we face. We need to encourage each other during those times. These are the actions that bind us together as God's family, where our thoughts, our speech, our example is as one. It's important to note that we're just not saying the same things. That's not what Romans 15, verse 6 is referring to. We're supposed to have the same attitude, the same mindset that Christ had. And that is an incredibly tall order for an ambassador of Christ. Thus, we are to encourage one another along the way. We should not be divided, but of one mind. Turn to 1 Corinthians 1, verse 10. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 10. It begins, "Now I plead." Paul is pleading with the Corinthians, "with you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and same judgment." The New Living Translation renders the scripture as follows: "I appeal to you, dear brothers and sisters, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, to live in harmony with each other. Let there be no divisions in the church, rather be of one mind, united in thought and purpose." As ambassadors for Christ, we are to be of one mind, to live in harmony, united in thought and purpose, one voice. How are we doing? The second of the three remaining responsibilities of a U.S. ambassador is that he or she carefully uses mission resources through regular review of programs, personnel, and funding level. The U.S. ambassador is to regularly review resources that are available. How does that apply in our walk? Turn to Psalms 24, verse 1. Psalms 24, verse 1. Psalms 24, verse 1. It states in Psalms 24, verse 1, "The earth is the Lord's in all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein." Everything belongs to God, and we are stewards of it. Because in reality, isn't what we've been given ultimately God's? So how do we manage our resources? How do we manage the resources we've been blessed with? How are we with stewardship? Webster's Dictionary defines stewardship as the careful and responsible management of something entrusted to one's care. Stewardship helps define our relationship with God. It identifies God as the owner and man as the manager. God makes man the co-worker in the administration of administering all aspects of life. Paul says it best by the following. Turn to 1 Corinthians 3, verse 9. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 9. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 9. It states, "For we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field. You are God's building." Adam Clark commentary makes the following statement regarding this verse. The word field signifies a properly arable field. It would be much more literal to translate it, "You are God's farm," which signifies properly sown field. You are God's building. You're not only the field which God cultivates, but you are the house that God builds, which in which he intends to dwell. So starting with this understanding, we are able to accurately view and correctly value not only our possessions, but more importantly, life itself. Stewardship is an administration of everything under our control, everything entrusted to us. It means that as stewards of God, we are managers of the things that belong to God, and we are under His authority to administer His affairs. And that's just not managing, keeping status quo, but we are to nurture, to grow, to invest what we've been given, to develop a skill, to obtain an education, to plan for the future, to grow in grace and knowledge. Turn to Matthew 25, verse 20. Matthew 25, verse 20. Matthew 25, verse 20. It states, so he had that had received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. And the Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you a ruler over many things. Enter to the joy of the Lord. Now, when we think of stewardship, we probably think of finances. How are we managing our finances? And that's true. Stewardship is about money, but it's not just about money. It's more than being just good handlers of material wealth. It is the understanding that all we have been given, all that is around us belongs to God, and that includes us. It's about living into our responsibility to care for others, to care for our environment, to care for the creation, all the blessings that we have been given, which God has given to us. Let's briefly consider some examples of proper stewardship. And it's not an exhaustive list, but I'd like us to consider some of these at this time. One example of proper stewardship is that we should be taking care of ourselves, the human vessels we have been given. One example of proper stewardship, we should be taking care of ourselves. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19. We should be taking care of ourselves. I'm reminded on this almost on a daily basis. I'm with now the Keck School of Medicine as chief operating officer. And one of the things I have to do almost every day, since my office is near our cancer hospital, is to walk through the cancer hospital. And I see the suffering and I see the pain of people going through horrible diseases and cancer. And we need to take care of ourselves. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19. Or do you not know that the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, who you have from God and are not your own? For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in our body, in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Corrine Bauer, in a certified Road Runners Club of America coach and author running by the book, and again, this is not your everyday Bible commentary, but she makes a good point about this verse. Paul is writing that our bodies belong to God. He bought them with the blood of Christ. Yet so many of us neglect our bodies, the Holy Spirit's home. Somehow we disconnect our spirits from our bodies. We work on our spiritual life while neglecting the physical. Or we strengthen our physical bodies without regard to our spiritual health. But God intends for us to turn everything over to Him, from nutrition to time in the Word, from exercise to prayer. God's desire is for us to honor Him in every aspect of our lives. Another example of proper stewardship is that we should be taking care of our children and our grandchildren through providing an inheritance. And we're familiar with this scripture, Proverbs 13:22, and no need to turn there, Proverbs 13:22, where it states, a good man leaves an inheritance to its children's children, but the sinner's wealth is laid up for the righteous. When we think of this proverb, it's a financial proverb, right? We think of it that way. But the Bible illustrator makes the following statement. The happiness of men depends less on their external conditions than on their personal virtues. The effects of a man's habits are transmitted to his children and even to their descendants. They derive from his character a sufficient and permanent inheritance. The commentary goes on by pointing out four types of inheritance that can be passed to children. The first, the instruction of a good man is an inheritance to his children. The habits of a young person acquires under his father's eye are the foundations of character. Number two, the example of a good man is an inheritance to his children. The character of the father lies at the foundation of his influence. The habits are his most successful admonitions. Third is the care and protection of a relationship with God are an inheritance to a good man's children. A good man will use his best endeavors to qualify his children for the business and duties of life, but chief is the dependence on God. And finally, the fourth, the kindness of a faithful man is an inheritance to a good man's children. Instruction, example, care and protection, kindness. Those are inheritances for our children and our grandchildren. It's more than a financial legacy that Proverbs 13:22 is talking about. It includes a legacy of character. Another way we can exercise proper stewardship is how we do manage our finances, the financial resources we have. Turn to Proverbs 27, verse 23. And I'd like to read from the New Living Translation for this. Sometimes the New Living provides an easier to understand translation and rendition of the scriptures. Proverbs 27, verse 23, but you can follow along. It states in Proverbs 27, verse 23, in the New Living Translation, "Know the state of your flocks, and put your heart into caring for your herds, for riches do not last forever, and the crown might not be passed to the next generation." We should be taking care of the finances that we have. Do we properly manage our finances against the many pulls we have that pulls against ourselves and ways to spend our earnings? Do we know the state of our flocks? We're not many of us are not in the agrarian business, but do we know the state of our flocks? That is the state of our finances. Do we have a budget we can live by? Do we keep an up-to-date checking account balance? Do we know what comprises the balance of our credit cards? Do we limit ourselves going to debt whenever possible? And if we are in debt, do we manage it? One of the keys in being a proper steward of our finances is that we appreciate what we have, no matter how small it is. If we are ungrateful, we'll be unappreciative. And then when we have an unappreciative mind, we'll fail to see what we really have, even in our minimal positions. And we can eventually find ourselves, because we're upset, because we're unhappy with our state, that we take financial risks that we should not be taking. And they can backfire. We are to be proper stewards with what we have been given. And in that vein, we are to use resources that are at our disposal. But noted earlier, one of the admonitions to the U.S. ambassador is that they carefully use mission resources. So in addition to our responsibility to exercise proper steward, we have various resources that we have as we go through our life. We not only have our relationship with God, His Spirit and the Word of God, but at times I believe we fail to use the greatest resource that God has given us, besides His Spirit, His relationship with Him, and His Word, and that is each other. Turn to Hebrews 24. Hebrews 10, verse 24. Hebrews 10, again, I'd like to read from the New Living Translation. Hebrews 10, verse 24. It states, let us think of ways to motivate each other to acts of love and good works. And let us not neglect the meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially as we see the day drawing near. The scripture notes that as we see the day drawing near, as the days become more difficult, more challenging, we are to meet together. Why? Because we are an incredible resource to each other. The ability to encourage one another. I realize this scripture many times is used as meeting together on the Sabbath, but whenever we have the opportunity, we should try to meet together, even outside of Sabbath services, to encourage one another, to share each other's way of life, what things are inspiring and what things are challenging. We can be the greatest resource of encouragement for each other. It is interesting that the embassy website notes that the ambassador is to carefully use the resources that he or she has available. The word carefully is in the first sentence. We too, ambassadors, must be careful how we use what's available to us. Leviticus 25, verse 17. And I'll read from the New International Version. Leviticus 25, verse 17. It states in Leviticus 25, verse 17, do not take advantage of each other, but fear your God. I am the Lord, your God. Now, the reference here is referring to land, selling of land, but the principle applies to all things. We are to look out for each other, pray for each other, encourage each other, but not to take advantage of the trust of one another. Our spiritual family is an incredible resource. As an ambassador of Christ, we should treasure everyone in God's family. A third duty, and the final one I'm covering in the message today of a U.S. ambassador, is that he or she serves Americans with professional excellence, the highest standards of ethical conduct and diplomatic discretion. Serves the Americans with professional excellence, the highest standards of ethical conduct, and diplomatic discretion. As an ambassador for Christ, we also should be using the highest standards in our lives to be people of excellence. And we can see this in the following scriptures, and I'm going to just read through them. I'd like you to listen to them. No need to turn to each one of these, but I'd just like to read them in order, because I believe it makes a better impact of who we are. Titus 2, verse 7 says, show yourself in all aspects to be a model of good works, and in your teaching show integrity and dignity. 1 Peter 2, 9 says, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Philippians 4, verse 8. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think on these things. Daniel 6, verse 3. Then this Daniel became distinguished above all other presidents and satraps because of an excellent spirit in him. And the king planned to send him over the whole kingdom. We are to be people of excellence, the highest standards, people of integrity, people of dignity. And too often in this society, I think we equate excellence with expensive. Excellence is a fine home, a luxury car. But the excellence we are to seek is excellence in speech, excellence in compassion, excellence in performing our responsibility, excellence in our relationships with one another, excellence in encouraging one another, excellence in parenting, excellence in spousing. I don't think that's a word, but you know what I mean. We are to do the best in all our situations. With this in background, I'd like to focus on the aspect of diplomatic discretion as noted in the responsibility of a U.S. ambassador, because it is applicable for us today. And I believe the strongest examples of this in the Bible is the scriptures relating to Paul at Mars Hill. If you turn to Acts 17, verse 22. Acts 17, verse 22. As background, Mars Hill served as a meeting place, the highest, the Areopagus court, the highest court for in Greece for civil, criminal, and religious matters. And even under Roman rule in the time of the New Testament, Mars Hill remained an important meeting place where philosophy and religion and law was discussed. And at the time of Paul, there were the Epicurean philosophers who generally believed that God existed, but was not interested nor involved in humanity. And life, the purpose of life was pleasure. There were the Stoic philosophers who had the world view that God was the world's soul, that goal of life was to rise above all things. So you shouldn't have any emotional response, neither to either pain or pleasure. Now turn to verse 22 of Acts 17. Then Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I perceive you are very religious. For I was passing through and considering the objects of your worship. I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' Therefore, the one you worship without knowing, him I proclaim to you." Now, Paul could have gone in there and attacked, criticized, mocked, but he used diplomatic discretion. He called them very religious and used that as the basis of explaining about the true God. Paul was keenly aware of his responsibility to all mankind. Romans 1, verse 14. Romans 1, verse 14. Romans 1, verse 14. "I am a debtor to both Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and the unwise." The New Living Translation provides the following translation: "For I have a great sense of obligation to the people in both the civilized world and to the rest of the world, to the educated and uneducated alike." William Barclay makes the following comment regarding this verse: "What Paul meant that his message, his friendship, his obligation was to the wise and to the simple, to the cultured and uncultured, to the lettered or unlettered, or basically to the educated and uneducated." What Paul was seeking there was common ground, the ability to understand people and their circumstances. Now, he didn't embrace their circumstances, but he wanted to understand. He established a common ground in understanding their circumstances. Turn to 1 Corinthians 9, verse 22. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 22. It states in 1 Corinthians 9, verse 22, says, "To the weak I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I become all things to all men, that I by all means save some." The New Living Translation provides the following rendition of this scripture: "When I am with those who are weak, I share their weakness, for I want to bring the weak to Christ. Yes, I find common ground with everyone, doing everything I can to save some." How about us today? Do we try to find common ground with others? In the process of finding common grounds, are we asked to compromise our core values? Of course not, and we shouldn't, and that's not what I'm saying. But what do we have in common? For example, if I were to say the word Muslim, would you be able to find common ground with someone of the Muslim faith? My wife and I have had the opportunity to work in the Muslim community for over 20 years. And we have made friends with those of the Muslim faith. And one time my wife had a discussion early on because they were intrigued by our beliefs that you're Christian yet you keep Jewish days. And my wife said, where they started the conversation and I give her great credit for this, where would you start if you're talking to someone of Muslim faith? She started with Abraham, right? There's a common ground with someone who's Muslim, Abraham. Muslims believe that Ishmael continued to be the firstborn, whereas we see in the Bible, the firstborn rights were passed to Abraham, to Isaac. The beginning of the millennium pictures a time when we'll be working with all sorts of people coming from all sorts of backgrounds. Will we be able to speak to them? Will we be able to relate? Will we be able to find common ground? We all have the privilege of being diplomatic in our communities, at our jobs, at each other, with those in the church, and especially within our own families. Being diplomatic in our walk is being kind, is being thoughtful. We are truthful, but we use wisdom and empathy. We use discretion. We filter our language. We consider the other person above ourselves. And unfortunately, it may be at times that we are the least diplomatic with those of our families. Those physical families. And right behind that are those members of our spiritual family. And as ambassadors for Christ, that should not be. As noted in the website, an ambassador is professional, exhibits high standards, and is diplomatic. And as ambassadors for Christ, we should be no less. We need to look at ourselves, examine our actions, examine our speech, examine our thoughts. Are we practicing the highest standards in what we do and how we treat each other, especially those of our physical and spiritual families, but also those around us in our communities? In this message, we examine three roles of a United States ambassador and applied it to ourselves as ambassadors for Christ, as ambassadors for the kingdom of God. First, an ambassador, noted on the website, speaks with one voice to others on U.S. policy. As ambassadors of Christ, we are to have the mind of Christ and speak the same thing. Not just saying the same words, but having the mind of Christ so deeply embedded in each one of us that we understand and believe the same. Secondly, an ambassador carefully uses mission resources through regular reviews of programs and personnel and funding levels. As an ambassador for Christ, we need to remind ourselves and we understand that everything belongs to God and we're to be proper stewards of it. We're responsible for the care and responsible of what has been entrusted to our care. It includes, but not limited to, taking care of ourselves, of our families through providing an inheritance and also financial resources. But it also includes the relationships we have with one another, especially as we see the day approaching. Finally, an ambassador serves Americans with professional excellence, the highest standards of ethical conduct, and diplomatic discretion. As ambassadors for Christ, we are to have the highest standards, to be people of excellence, integrity, and dignity. We are to be diplomatic, to find common ground with others, in order to set the proper example of our calling. And being ambassadors for Christ are not limited to those who are baptized. It applies to all of us, young and old. For we all are ambassadors of Christ. We are all people of excellence. In the beginning of this message, I noted that President Obama, in accepting his award, thank the people at the USC Shoah Foundation for setting alight an internal flame of testimony that can't be extinguished and cannot be denied. We know that we are called to be a light. As ambassadors for Christ, the Word of God, and we have the promise of God that cannot be extinguished, that cannot be denied. Our walk in this way is more than a journey. We have responsibilities. Each and every one of us as an ambassador for Christ. We're representatives of God and his kingdom in all we do. So the question we must ask ourselves, how are we doing? Are we a reflection of God through us? Are we? Turn to 1 Peter 2, verse 9. 1 Peter 2, verse 9. I like to read from the Living Translation. 1 Peter 2, verse 9. It states in 1 Peter 2, 9, but you are not like that, for you are a chosen people. Do we view ourselves as a chosen people? You are royal priest, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God. For example, Mr. Bob Dick talked about how Jerusalem will show others. Well, we have that opportunity now to show others the goodness of God, for he has called us out of the darkness into his wonderful light. During the feast, we will be reminded of our future of being kings and priests, but we have a role now. Our role is to be ambassadors for Christ, not only at this feast site, but when we go back to our communities, back to our jobs, that is our role. So it doesn't matter if you're preteen, teen, young adult, middle-aged, retirement age, baby boomer, Generation X, Generation Y, millennial, all of us, each and every one of us have a responsibility. We have a role. So if you feel you don't have a role in the church, maybe a responsibility, we all do. We're all in this together. We're ambassadors for Christ. Fellow ambassadors, have a great remainder of the feast.